lorsqu'on parle de biodiversité,
when
il
talking
est de
about biodiversity,
d'animaux, de plantes, même peut-être
people
de bactéries,
show pictures, animals, plants, bacteria, nice, good looking, in order to convince the audience that biodiversity is very nice, it's pretty, it should be preserved, it's important. But showing things this way, there are two problems. It's a manipulation because we might have taken other pictures with a less positive interpretation of biodiversity, but more seriously, it gives us a picture of biodiversity that looks like a collection of stamps. How do we perceive and how do we use biodiversity? Perception.
Perception.
Well, we have found biodiversity a long time ago. It's not necessary to be sapiens to differentiate a dog. A dog knows the difference between a cat and a mouse. There are species, we've always known that. But what do we do with that knowledge? This is a picture from the 17th century botanic books at the time. A tree, when the leaves fall in water, they turn into fishes, and when they fall on the land, they turn into birds. At the same time, the microscope was invented. The spermatozoa were discovered, and the next idea was that in spermatozoa there was a little man, and the little man would develop in the mother's womb. This is a scandal. We still tell children the father places a little seed in the mother's womb, but we have to stop telling children that the seed is made by the mother, and the father does very little. It's not a seed that is deposited by the father. But at the time, the seed was said to be given by the father. There are things in our terminology, and we still talk about seed. And people thought that if it fell on the ground, it gave birth to the mandragore, a hybrid plant. Metamorphosis, the tree leaves that become birds, and hybrids between plants and human beings. Every species was a category, but we could move from one to another with metamorphosis. Only in the 18th century, it was decided that metamorphosis could not happen between species. And yet, metamorphosis happens. Caterpillar will become a butterfly, but if a caterpillar becomes a butterfly, then they must belong to the same species. This is a decision because the species is no longer recognizable through its shape, but the genealogy, the time continuity, and therefore species has a time dimension. I'm not absolutely certain that naturalists at the time understood this, but once we had fixated the species, we were able to classify it by diversity, and there was a new science, systematics, that produces classification classes, and the prince at the time was Caroline Linné, who came up with the denomination for the species, and then he came up with the hierarchical system, classes, orders, genera, species, and in species, subspecies, and varieties. And Linné did this on a very clear theoretical category. All species find their origin in the strain from the hand of the creator, because the alter in nature creating species, because species were created, and by creating species, our Lord imposed on his creatures an eternal law of reproduction and multiplication in the limits of their own type. So species were created, they were perennial, and they could not be changed. And Carl Linné suggested the world that had been created once and for all and was totally stable. So in order to preserve biodiversity, well, it's very simple. All you need to do, it's written in the Bible, you take a couple of each species of animals and you place them in a boat, and that's it. But it doesn't work, because if there's only one couple, there is in breeding and the population will disappear after a while. So people looking at conservation found that they had to look at diversity within the species, but they were interested because it was necessary to preserve the species, but not for itself. The species is an entity, a stable entity, the basis of biodiversity. That is a perception we still have nowadays. Many people, when they think about biodiversity, think the diversity between the species. But species do not always behave as they should. They exchange genes. Nature was considered as perfectly made by our Creator for the benefit of human beings. Bernard Saint-Pierre, at the end of the 18th century, said that watermelon were divided in slices by nature to be eaten in the family, but a pumpkin was bigger and could be eaten with your neighbors. Well, the perfect world at the end of the 18th century was changed when people, Cuvier, discovered the fact that species could become extinct. That was a trauma at the time. Species were not immortal any longer. And in the middle of the 19th century, Darwin's theory appeared based on natural selection. Natural selection, which has to do with reproduction, variation, and nature sorts out the forms that work best. And the natural selection process allows Darwin to explain the emergence of biodiversity, the origin of species, the origin of diversity. And when Darwin calls his book The Origin of Species, this is really a wink, because he's not interested in the origins of species, but rather in the origin of various forms of living beings, variety, subspecies, genera. He summarizes his ideas with this pattern. The only picture published in The Origin of Species, and this pattern, this graph shows how extinction happens and how divergence with natural selection explain the emergence of biodiversity. Now, biodiversity is something that is constantly moving forward. It doesn't limit itself to a series of species. In this graph, lineages are between two different populations, and then they become different varieties, subspecies, genera, species, genera, and therefore biodiversity works exactly the same way at all levels. Biodiversity is diversity between species, then diversity within species, and there is a meaningless barrier, because there is biodiversity is a continuous process which needs to be understood, especially once we think about perception of biodiversity. We can use biodiversity. How do we treat biodiversity today? I'll give you an example. International agriculture. In international agriculture, everything is being standardized. This is a cultivation of transgenic soya bean in Southern America. What happens in Canada, for instance? This gentleman used to cultivate rapeseed, and his neighbors used the Monsanto seeds, and the seeds would fly to his field, and he the crop was based on Monsanto seeds, and Monsanto sued him and said he could no longer use his seeds because his seeds contained Monsanto genes. So he was contaminated by his neighbor and lost property ownership of his own seeds. So if you allow the wind to take the pollen to the neighbor's field, your neighbor's seed will belong to you. You will eliminate your neighbor's seed. There is a war between seeds now, and very few companies own almost all of the genetic stock across the planet. This will happen within 20 years if we allow patents on seeds to continue. Oh, don't worry, this will be solved. People will find solutions to preserve biodiversity of cultivated plants, because obviously it's serious that we no longer have biodiversity of cultivated plants. Because if there is no biodiversity, a single disease would decimate all crops. But it won't happen. There are altruistic people, including Bill Gates, because Bill Gates, well, he's one of the main shareholders of Monsanto. But he came up with the idea to make a huge underground fridge in Svalbard in Norway, where they're going to organize Noah's Ark of cultivated plants. All seeds will be kept in a huge fridge, except the plants. The seeds will be kept in the fridge. They will die because they will lose their germination properties. But don't worry. They have thought about it, and they are working on synthetic biology, and the dead seed will be resuscitated. This will happen. So we are creating systems where we suppress biodiversity on the surface of Earth, keeping it in the form of DNA in underground fridges. This vision of biodiversity matches a vision where biodiversity has been created and was preserved in fridges. But in reality, biodiversity doesn't work that way. Biodiversity must be able to evolve. So keeping synthetic biology in fridges to resuscitate plants is simply putting the 20th century technology to the benefit of 18th century knowledge. And if we continue that way, international agriculture will suffer a lot. There will be sanitary issues due to increased homogeneity. Someday, what biologists are doing now by patenting genes and standardizing agriculture is a crime against humanity. Davidoff, a geneticist, a Russian geneticist beginning of the 20th century, showed that cultivated plants work exactly like wild systems. They are diversified by selection processes. This diversity is the insurance for us that future generations will have enough plants to feed on, in spite of climatic changes. And what matters is that we preserve biodiversity, that we allow biodiversity to function in cultivated plants and in crops. And this means we have to change our agricultural system.